This is ridiculous. How can they get away with putting perfectly good rechargeable lithium batteries in a single-use device? And why does it seem like there are so many more of these around all of a sudden? Hey, I'm Becky, and I'm going to show you how to reuse these batteries for your own electronics projects. Subscribe and hit that like button if you like the idea of diverting valuable and hazardous substances from landfill while acquiring free batteries for your projects. I think it has something to do with the Juul ban. Juul had a significant share of the market with its rechargeable, cartridge refillable device available in all those fruity flavors. When it was pulled from the US market in 2022 by the FDA, banning the fruity flavors, new competitors popped up to fill the demand in a market where now brand recognition could mean a target on your back from regulators. So they're not incentivized to make a refillable system, and selling you a completely new device every time the old one wears out is more profitable anyway than selling you just a cartridge. So unless lithium becomes much more scarce, or it becomes a legal requirement to make them infinitely refillable, I don't see this trend changing anytime soon, unfortunately. I did find some brands that have a charging circuit included to make use of a larger liquid reservoir. But once the liquid runs out, the device is still intended to be thrown out. Taking apart anything with a lithium battery in it is dangerous. You have to be careful not to damage the battery or short it out, or you could quickly have a concentrated fire hazard on your hands. So don't do this at home without the supervision of somebody who knows what they're doing.
Lithium batteries are used in many everyday devices like laptops, cell phones, hybrids, and electric cars. They are much lighter than traditional alkaline batteries and can last much longer. They can also be recharged multiple times, so it's no wonder they're in everything nowadays. Lithium batteries contain layers of materials folded up together into a small shape. Energy is stored on either side of a battery stack, and it wants to get from one side to the other, and we power our circuits by making the charges do work for us along the way. When charging, the opposite happens. You can think of the act of charging like pushing the energy back to the other side so it can be ready to go again. And if the layers are breached by, say, a puncture or by crushing, the battery can become shorted out and the electrons get way too excited. The C rate is the measure of how quickly the battery can be discharged and recharged without damaging it.
It's like if you're filling up a bucket of water with an eye droplet or a pipette versus a fire hose.
Here's a list of do's and don'ts when using LiPoly batteries. Do charge your battery at a rate appropriate for its capacity. Store your battery in a cool place. Get a fireproof bag to keep your batteries in. Don't charge or discharge your battery too quickly or let it get too hot. Don't leave your battery unattended while charging. And don't discharge your battery below its minimum voltage level. How did I get this many devices to take apart? Besides picking them up off the sidewalk, I asked on my local Buy Nothing group and found a few willing folks who knew better than to throw these in the trash and were happy to offload their hoard. I cracked open the cases using an awl and hammer to apply force to the seams in the plastic enclosures. Then the whole circuit and tank assembly usually just slides right out. If it doesn't, you can reach in with pliers and pull on the plastic tank, not the battery or its wires. I recommend wearing gloves when handling and disposing of the liquid tank, and give the battery a wipe before removing your gloves. When I didn't, I had a hard time getting the smell out of my fingers, even after washing my hands. This whole process is pretty smelly, and I think you can absorb the ingredients through your skin, too. These 280 and 350 milliamp hour batteries are about $5 retail and perfect for wearables or other portable projects. I desoldered them from the other circuitry and soldered the two wire connections to a new JST plug with plenty of heat shrink tubing to insulate the connections and relieve any strain on the tiny, tiny battery wires. To charge these up, you can't just connect them to power. You need a charger circuit with appropriate settings for the size of the battery. The charger monitors the battery and fills it up gradually and safely. This one has a dip switch, so you can toggle the charging rate. choose the fastest rate without going over the capacity of the battery. So for this 350 milliamp hour battery, I'd choose to charge at 300 milliamps. This one has solder pads you can bridge to set the charging rate. I'll choose 200 for these 280 milliamp hour batteries. I picked up these chargers and the JST wires at DigiKey, the sponsor for this video. They carry everything you need to reuse these batteries and they ship super fast. You can find all the info at the link in the description. These large capacity ones are nice for reusing because they come with a charge circuit. It's been interesting to see that which charging chip varies quite a bit. Some of these are integrated overvoltage and overcurrent protection chips, and others just put a couple PNP transistors on there and call it a day. So depending on the quality of the included charge circuit, you may wish to use it or lose it. The difference between these batteries and the nicer ones you might buy is the protection circuitry, or lack thereof. Lithium batteries can be damaged if they are drained or charged too much or too fast. And good hobby batteries will have a little circuit on them that cuts off the power when their voltage dips too low, goes too high, and protects against shorts and dangerously high current with an overcurrent cutout. These batteries usually don't have any of that, so you need to add that circuitry yourself or leave the battery connected to a charger that has protection circuitry built in and is set to the proper charging rate for your battery. To protect against accidental shorts after the battery's out of the enclosure, I added some tape and/or heat shrink to the exposed contacts. Obviously, it's not a great idea to be adding any amount of heat to these batteries, so I was very judicious. This tape isn't the right kind either. You should be using a high-temp Kapton tape, but this is better than just chucking all of these bare batteries in a box together and expecting them not to catch on fire. When the device designers put these together, they knew the current draw would never exceed that of the air sensor and heater in the device. When reusing these batteries, thermal runaway could be a real concern. If your circuit draws more current than the battery is rated for, the conservative rule of thumb is the battery capacity per hour, you could start an unstoppable chain reaction inside the battery that causes it to explode. Remember the Samsung Galaxy Note 7?
Message from Samsung. Turn off your Galaxy Note 7s immediately to avoid something like this happening to you.
So in conclusion, I encourage you to pick up these devices if you see them littered and at least get them to proper e-waste recycling. Don't let them go into the ocean. And maybe use them to power your next solar device. I'll link to a few good candidate projects in the write-up linked in the description.
If you liked this video, please give it a thumbs up and share it with a friend. I hope you'll subscribe with the bell to be notified of my future uploads, subscribe to my email newsletter, and find me on your favorite social media platform. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. This video was made with support from my sponsors and generous donations from viewers like you through Patreon and YouTube memberships.